Last Sunday, I made a statement about Scripture, about the text of Scripture. I want to go back to that because, you know, we are currently talking about these opportunities that we have in our daily walk that allow us to grow, to have these, we call them spiritual growth spurts, to kind of get a kickstart in our spiritual lives, both individually, you know, as you and I individually grow in Christ, but then also corporately as a church. We have these opportunities as churches to grow. And from Scripture, what we're finding is you open these up and there's these fascinating stories that you read. You know, wonderful stories, and in here you see God's hand at play and the great things that take place by which God is doing, and he's using people to accomplish his will. Great stories, you know, we spend a lot of time on those, and we witness those. We get to hear about them because they've been so well preserved in Scripture for all these thousands of years that we have those. But my point last week was, you know, we're not just witnesses, we're not just to spectate, you know, we are to participate in it. And that's the part of this reading that is active and it's dynamic, because it causes us as we read this to encounter God and to come to know him, and then to respond, perhaps to change or to become different and to move us along in our paths. And so, you know, we said this last week, that no doubt when you read these stories, you know, pick a story in the Bible, anywhere in there, in that story there is an encounter of God in that story. But then maybe the newer idea, you might not have heard it put this way again, or this way, is there's an encounter with God in the reading of the stories. And boy, that kind of hits home, and that becomes powerful, because now, you know, this isn't just something that I read from a historical perspective, or I read it just for mere knowledge, or I read it just because it sort of has an entertainment value to it. No. You know, that second part of that says that there is an encounter with God, with you and him, when you read it. And that is for you and me, and it's for here and now. And that encounter is just as powerful and just as cool as the parting of the seas, or turning the water to wine, or the dead being raised again, because it is the same God that encounters you and I when we read. And so that's kind of what we've been doing here. We've been going back and we've been looking at these stories in the Bible to see where these spiritual growth spurts were taking place. And then we're trying to get ourselves planted in the story a little bit more and to think about Scripture that way, that we are participants in these stories as well because we're reading them. And we're called to be challenged by them as well. If you have your Bibles and want to follow along today's, we're going to be in John chapter 8. And this is the story about a woman caught in a crime and brought before Christ. So starting in verse 1 of chapter 8, as we look at this in the lens of where were their spiritual growth opportunities for the characters in this story, we begin by Jesus saying, "Early in the morning, he came to the temple. All the people came to him and sat down, and he began to teach them. But then the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery and making her stand before all of them. They, those religious leaders, said to him, 'Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now what do you say?' And they said this to test him, so that they might have some charge to bring against him." Now note about the story there, you know, that's just not the facts of the story. We have a lot of facts of the story there, but, you know, the author of that, I think, is kind of editorializing a little bit. He's helping us understand a little bit about what's going on, because what he says, he gives us the reason that those religious leaders brought that woman there. You know, that he's telling us why. You know, it was, we need to know this fact. They did this because it says that they might have some charge to bring against him. That was the motivation behind these church leaders, you know, they came in the middle of this teaching to bring this woman. The law that Moses gave us tells us that this happened and this is what needs to happen as punishment. And there's nothing wrong with what they're saying about the law, because if you go back and read in Leviticus 20 or Deuteronomy 22, they're right about that. The law is pretty explicit about the woman caught in this crime and what the punishment needs to be. So that part of the story is true. But can you sense that there is, you know, right away there would have been tension. You know, imagine here we've got this crowd that came to hear his teaching. You know, they came into the temple and they sat down on his feet and they wanted to hear him speak. And now you got this big interruption that's taken place. Well, you know, if you back up just a little bit, why were they there? You know, why were these people there? You know, and what we've learned from Scripture, that Jesus is gaining some popularity because of his teaching and because of the actions that he's done up to this point. You know, it wasn't that much further back. If you flip your Bibles back a few pages, you know, it was there that Jesus fed those 5,000 people with just a couple of loaves of bread and a couple of fish. Remember that? And so that was fascinating to these people. They saw that. And it was shortly after that he walked on the water. Remember, and he calmed the storm. And then he begins to give this teaching that says, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." And he teaches them again, "Let anyone who's thirsty come to me." And so those are things that would have happened before. But it was because he was saying those things that it was resonating with these people, and that's why he was so popular. And so that's why the text says, you know, early in the morning he goes to the temple, and the crowds came. They wanted more. They wanted to hear more of this teaching. And in fact, the religious leaders are listening to this. And in chapter 6, just before this text, it says, "How does this man have such learning when he has never been taught?" Those would have been the religious leaders. That's their response to Jesus, because they're seeing this popularity. And they're hearing this teaching. Saying, you know, how's he do this? He never went to Oxford. You know, he never went to Princeton or whatever. He never learned under Gamaliel, the Jewish priest at the time. So there was this great hunger from these people to just get more. You know, we want to see some more of this, and we want to hear some more of this, because they're drawn to this teaching that we know now that it was such authoritative teaching, and they were drawn to that. But then comes this interruption. You know, these guys come in and they do their thing. Think about these men that brought this woman in. Think of how, you know, have the word devouring. They have that in their attitude. They have this desire to devour, and to just, you know, they disgracefully present this woman who's presumed condemned already. It's what they do. And why is it they're doing that? I'm trying to put myself in the sandals of these guys. What is it they're after? And, you know, maybe one of the things they're doing is, you know, all this teaching that they're questioning. Where'd you get this authority? It's awful ideological. You know, maybe let's get him down to reality a little bit. You know, you just see these guys, you know, mocking him. You know, worshiping in spirit and in truth. And, you know, anyone come to me who is his thirsty. You know, that's the teaching that you're teaching. You say, "Yeah, I'm the bread from heaven," and so on. You know, "For God so loved the world," yada yada yada. But, you know, these guys might be saying, "Well, what about real world stuff? That's all pie in the sky kinds of things. What about real world stuff, where this woman has been caught in the very act of adultery? What sayest thou?" You know, let's get this to, you know, where the rubber meets the road kind of thing. All that other stuff seems pretty philosophical and not really in touch with reality. Maybe that was some of their motivation. And then think about the woman. Think about the humiliation she would be experiencing at this time. We have no evidence that there's anyone there at all to defend her. Probably not too many women in the crowd, because they're typically not in the crowds where men would be teaching. That was just kind of a no-no at the time. You know, and then what about the other person? You know, pretty obvious it takes at least more than one to commit adultery. What happened to the other one in the party? You don't hear anything about that. You know, that would be going on in her mind as well. And, you know, just think of the very state she would be in. You know, it says she was caught in the very act, so she probably didn't have time to, you know, make sure her nails and her makeup was all right and make sure she had the right outfit on either. You know, you probably have an idea of what that appearance would be like for her. So you have Jesus and then these main three sets of characters that make up the telling of this story. You know, you've got the crowd that came to hear him teach. You've got the religious leaders that came in for the purpose of tripping up Jesus. And then you have this woman who has been caught up in this crime. But remember what I said last week, that this similar story as well, there's another very important character in that story, and that's you and me. It's you and me as we read this, as we engage this story. What does it mean for us? Because it was written for that purpose, that you and I would find life in that story, because we're participating in it. We have a role. We have a role to play in the story, in how the story is to finish. We're going to hear things in this story. We're going to make identifications with people in the story or characters in their story, and then we're called to respond to it. The characters in the story are confronted with something, we'll find out in a moment, and they need to respond. But you and I as well, too. I think we're confronted with something that we need to respond to as well. So, you know, let's do that. Let's look a little more deeply at this story using this lens of where was it where there's these spiritual growth spurts where people were given the opportunity to say, yeah, that's right. This is where I am, but God's calling me to be here. What could happen in our own lives if we would do the same thing as we engage ourselves in that story? So back up just a little bit. Imagine you are one of those people in the crowd that came to the temple in that morning to hear his teaching. Then or now, you're one of these people that are hungry for the truth that would come from Jesus. What are you hoping for? What do you want to hear? You're one of those people that are sitting in that crowd. What is it that you hope to gain from listening to Jesus? Are you and I, are we coming to him daily as these people were doing then? Are we coming? Do we have the hunger to come to him, to hear from him today in 2020 in our own homes through prayer, through scripture? This is how he's going to speak to us primarily. In studies, in small groups. You know, are we doing this frequently, coming to him to hear from him and to learn from him? And then there's the interruption. You know, they came to learn, they came to hear, they came to be taught, and then boom, you know, this thing happens where these guys come in with this woman. And that's not that much different than us today. What interruptions do we have from our learning from him? The world comes to destroy. That's the purpose of the world, to destroy this good thing that we may have between us and God through our relationship with his son. So what keeps you from hearing his teaching? What in this world is interrupting you from hearing him? What in the world is attacking the message that he has for you, or to counteract the message that he has for you? There's kind of a understood question there as I asked you those. A lot of questions today I'm going to have you think through. But if time with your teacher is not at the center of your day, or at least very frequently throughout your life, that you're coming to him daily, well, why not? Why not? What is your interruptions? Who are the ones trying to work against you? Why aren't we spending the time that we should be spending coming to know him in prayer and in the word and with other believers? That's getting in the sandals of the people at Jesus' feet. Trying to get in the sandals of the religious leaders that came, those scribes and Pharisees that came. Why are they doing what they're doing? They're bringing in this accused person, perhaps looking for punishment for her. But I wonder if maybe they're coming to spotlight or to highlight the sin in someone else's life Because if I do that, that'll make the sin in my life a lot more dim. We ever find ourselves doing that? Is it ever tempting to showcase the sin in those guys, because it sure makes the sin in my life a lot less, or seem a lot less? It's tempting to throw light on somebody that's caught stealing, or someone that's accused of sexual immorality or alcohol abuse. Easy to kind of do that in subtle kind of ways. It's easy to look at those kinds of sins, because that kind of diminishes the fact that I'm gossiping about them. That'd be a sin as well. It also diminishes this lusting desire that I battle with all the time, because it's inner and no one knows about it. It also diminishes this greed that I have in my life. It also diminishes my bigotry and my prejudice that I have. It also diminishes the hateful speech that I have, or the insensitivity I have. If I can point out the visible sins that are in someone else. Yeah, I get it a little bit. I understand those. I can kind of understand the nature of those leaders that brought this woman to Christ, because it sure makes me look a little bit better in my Sunday clothes, in my garb. It's easy to do. Let's make the sins of someone else out to be bigger than they really are. And then there's the woman. Try to place ourselves in the story of this woman. There's nothing in here to say that perhaps she was falsely accused. In fact, there's probably more evidence that they brought her, and she probably was guilty, because law says you have to have two witnesses in order for someone to be properly accused. So we could probably assume that she was guilty of the crime that she was accused of. So she's caught, and she is exposed, and she's guilty. And you know, when I think about that, I think about, you know, myself being caught. You know, I still remember, it's been a while, but, you know, I still remember getting caught, you know, when you're a kid or whatever. You know, you did it, you're guilty, you're done. You know, the blood leaves your face and your eyes get beady, and, you know, yeah, you're giggling because you all been there too, right? That, you know, you've been there. You know, you have that, you've got that, oh, I still think about some of that stuff, and oh boy, I hope my dad doesn't find out. You know, I wouldn't be here today if he didn't found out some of this stuff. He'd kill me. But it's still there, you know, and yeah, no doubt I look back on some of those things. Yeah, maybe there are some smaller kinds of things, but still that idea of guilt, you know, and I think about her, what would be going through her mind, you know, that she's there as we see her in the, you know, on the ground here. And just wondering what is going through her mind in terms of the guilt that she would feel. And then this talk that's going on about what these leaders said that must take place. You know, the law says that she needs to be stoned. That's going through her mind. How is she processing that? You know, maybe that first stone will just hit me in the head or something and knock me out. So I just can't imagine what would be coming. Yeah, she's guilty, and I'm drawn to that character. I can identify with that character because I'm guilty as well. Big picture kind of things. You know, you think about, did you ever lie? Have you ever lusted? Have you ever gossiped? Have you ever demonstrated hate? Have you ever hoarded money? Or you ever put something at a higher position than God? Well, I have. I'll admit I have. I've done that. And because of that, because of the very first one I did, that now puts me at a position outside of the presence of God. He is so perfectly holy that the very first sin separates me from Him. And I would venture to bet a lot of money. There I am betting again. There's the next sin. That the rest of us have done the same as well. Because we all sin. We all, the Scripture says, fall short of the glory of God, and we're all guilty. We're all guilty. Story goes on and says, after they pushed Jesus here, Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. What a fascinating scene. You know, people have thought an awful lot about what's happening there. What do you write? What did he write? We don't know. Scripture doesn't tell us what he did. Well, why'd you bend down? Well, we don't know. We just don't know. We have to kind of guess. But, you know, I kind of think there's a little bit of Jesus sort of saying, I'm not even going to respect that question kind of thing. There's just a little bit of, you know what I mean? I'm just kneeling down here, you know, because Jesus knows. He knows their heart. What do you suppose the people were thinking about when he did that? You know, all those people that came in the crowd and all that awesome teaching and the signs that they saw and all these things. And now, boy, he's put on the spot. And now he bends down and he writes something on the ground. You know, are they thinking, well, I know the law says that. Maybe there's stones on the ground and maybe they're watching to see if he's going to pick up a stone and be the first one, because that's what the law says. But you know, Jesus knows the very heart of everybody that's in this scene. He knows exactly why those leaders brought that woman there. He knows that. Therefore, he kneels down and writes in the ground. He knows exactly the hearts of all those people that came to hear him speak. And he also knows the very heart and the core of this woman who has been accused. But do not miss out on the fact that he knows perfectly well your heart as you and I read this story and are called to respond to it. So the story goes on and says, you know, they kept on questioning him, and he straightens up and said to them, let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. And at once he bent down and wrote on the ground again. And I think this, at the point in the story, is this spiritual growth opportunity number one right here. He stood up and he says, let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. And in that just short amount of time that it would have taken that sentence to come from his lips, and the time that he would have knelt back down and put his hand in the dust to do whatever he was doing there, there probably would have been a million different kind of thoughts going through everybody in the minds of the people that were experiencing this. And I would imagine, speculatively here, that there were some people that were thinking, in that brief amount of time, they thought, well, yeah, I don't have sin. And they, you know, just for a half a second, they would have thought, my sin's not as bad as hers. And they would have thought with that rock and just, you know, but it would have taken a millisecond for them to realize, this is just me with my chest out, puffed up self-righteousness. And in my heart, when I think about the question that he just asked, let anyone among you who is without sin, they would have realized, that ain't me. That ain't me, because I have sin as well. And it says that it started from the older ones. The elders dropped their stones and left, and then the younger ones followed, because those older ones, probably in their maturity, realized a second more quickly, I too am a sinner. I too am not worthy to carry out this punishment. Because a key in this story, I think, for all of us to see is no one is without sin. Jesus highlights this. Anyone who was without sin cast the first stone. No one could cast the stone. Point here is, I think, all are guilty. You and I, again, I said, are participants in the story, and that puts us there too. We are guilty. We're guilty as well. When they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the elders, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. You know, I think in our marred human nature, you know, just because we're human doesn't make us bad, I don't believe, but I think what makes us bad, we're marred because of sin. We have this tremendous potential, I believe, to hate, to just do what is against love, to act in an opposite way. And it's so evident in this story. It's part of our nature, and I think we just can't deny that. It's just part of who we are when left alone. And I thought about how I might illustrate this, how do you illustrate that humanity by itself just has this propensity or this tendency to act opposite of love or to act out of hate. And, you know, it would have taken me about 2 minutes to get on the internet and start searching for the current news stories, and I got to throw in all kinds of awesome contemporary current pictures up there demonstrating how our world's just full of hate. But nah, I think what would be more effective is if I could somehow show my and your instances where we didn't love, or we acted out of hate. We have this desire or this thing in us that we want to condemn, as these religious leaders did, and we want to judge, and we want to see other people held accountable. So they all walk away. Jesus straightened up and he says to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on do not sin again." Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn you. He did not come here to condemn the world. Remember, just earlier, just a few chapters back, these people would have remembered this teaching that Jesus taught to Nicodemus. He said, "Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in me are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God." There it is. There is Jesus acting out those words that he said. "I didn't come here to condemn the world. I came to the world to save it." And now perfectly illustrated is with this woman. "I've not come here to condemn you, but go and sin no more." And then, you know, there is the overarching truth of this story. There was a sin, and there is a necessity for that penalty to be paid for that sin. You know, that part of the story was right, but the religious leaders were just getting it so wrong. They didn't see the big picture of what Jesus was going to do. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for our sins, but also for the sins of the whole world. That's 1 John 2:2. That sin that she committed was atoned for by the cross. Those sins that I committed from 1961 on have been atoned for because of that sacrifice that he did for me. And for you as well. Those in the story, all those people in the story, the crowd that came, the woman, and those religious leaders were all confronted with this truth that Jesus exposed to them. They're all guilty. And that's where we participate in that story as well, because we are all, without Christ, guilty. And they heard this. They participated in that story. And he heard this truth that he had come not to condemn, but to save. And like all these other stories in the Bible, we don't know how they responded. What'd the woman do? What'd the crowd do? What'd the religious leaders do? Doesn't matter. What matters is what you and I will do. Let's stand and close the prayer. Father, it does matter what we do, but what we do is only because what you have done, what you have done for us. Remind us once again of the power of the cross. It's a big idea, but it also is so small because it is for each of us individually. Allow your Spirit to take that truth that was revealed once again to us through your word to penetrate our hearts, to challenge us to change, to go from here and be people that aren't those grumbling people, but people that are truly happy all the time because we're saved in you. Praise your name. Amen. Have a great week.
In a time full of worldly peace, in a time full of doubt, just move. Yeah, there ain't that much difference between you and me. In a time full of worldly peace, in a world.